A very good morning to all our viewers. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television and I'm Smriti Rasogi with Breakfast News. In the next 30 minutes, we will get you all the national, international and sports news. But before we begin the bulletin, a quick look at the top headlines. Pakistan Army rules out consular access to Kulbhushan Jadhav, dismisses compromise on the issue. New Delhi says no communication from Pakistan on the denial of consular access. Tamil Nadu ministers emergency meeting today to discuss merger of two AIADMK factions. This after former Chief Minister O Paneerselvam flags unity proposal. Students hit streets across valley, clash with police and paramilitary forces. All schools and colleges in the valley shut. Home Ministry tells forces to use pellet guns only as last resort. CBI closes in on Trinamool in Narda case probe. FIR lodged against 12 party leaders and officials for alleged corruption. And tensions rise in the Korean Peninsula. North Korea warns of nuclear war possibility, says it will continue to test missiles after US says its patience with Pyongyang was over. In what can be called as a major hint towards suing up an unprecedented merger between the two warring factions of the AIADMK, the Sasikala and OPS camp met late on Monday night to discuss and deliberate over the possibilities of the unification. State Finance and Fisheries Minister D. Jayakumar hinted about this development after the meeting. Two parallel meetings were held at the residences of the state ministers, Thangamani and Udumalai Radhakrishnan. There is a possibility that the reunited party will then claim for the AIADMK symbol of two leaves. The development came on a day when the Delhi police booked Sasikala's AIADMK faction leader, TTV Dinakaran, for allegedly trying to bribe an election commission official in a failed bid to obtain the party symbol. Meanwhile, the former Chief Minister O Paneerselvam had earlier expressed confidence that the TTV Dinakaran-led faction leaders would approach him for merger talks. The MLAs belonging to the two camps are expected to hold a meeting in Chennai today and discuss the merger.
We are ready to whatever the talks actually between OPS and ours means we welcome. OPS opened, we are ready means we are also ready for that. Morning our Deputy Speaker of Parliament clearly told that it's a welcome message. So we actually stick on to that.
Delhi's crime branch filed an FIR against TTV Dinakaran, the deputy general secretary of the AIADMK Sasikala faction. The police charged Dinakaran with allegedly trying to bribe an election commission official. Dinakaran has claimed that efforts were being made to destroy his organization politically. The police action comes after the arrest of an alleged middleman, Sukesh Chandrasekhar, from a five-star hotel in Delhi on Sunday.
How does a broker or somebody say that it is money from TTV Dinakaran? The person whom I doesn't know, only just now I saw him in the TV channel, some English channel, his photograph, he is arrested. Like, if there is any summon from the police, Delhi police, I will legally face it. What is there? I will answer them. And I don't know anybody by this name. I didn't ever come in my life in that name, Sukesh Chandrasekhar. And I didn't bribe for bribe to anybody for anything.
The alleged bribe was offered in an attempt to get AIADMK's poll symbol of two leaves in a by-election to the RK Nagar Assembly seat in Tamil Nadu. Sasikala's faction adopted the hat symbol after the election commission froze the two-leaf symbol, acknowledging the split in the party. The O Paneerselvam camp was given the electric poll symbol.
Today we have filed thousands of affidavits which were given by the supporters of Mr. O. Paneerselvam, who is the head of the True AIADMK, before the election commission, in order to establish that we are the True AIADMK and we are entitled for the two-leaf symbol. And we have also sought time for filing lakhs of affidavits before the election commission by the office bearers and the primary members of the AIADMK party.
At least 1.3 crore rupees was recovered from Chandrasekhar that police claim he was planning to use to bribe EC officials. Around 50 crore rupees were paid as bribe. An FIR was filed under Section 8 of the Prevention of Corruption Act that pertains to taking gratification by corrupt or illegal means to influence public servants. Dinakaran will be served notice to join the investigation.
That shows their desperation in capturing the party and power. See, whenever the leader is no more, the party without a second-rank leader is bound to split, because both the sides are being power mongers. They want to capture both the power and the party. That is what is going on now. But this is a very shameful thing that this has gone to this extent of bribing the election commission.
These people are mafia people. These people are criminals indulging in bad activities where Tamil Nadu people don't like them at all. That's why I'm insisting again and again, requesting Honorable Prime Minister to invoke 356 at Tamil Nadu. Because every minister there, even the chief minister, involved in corruption and involved in all illegal activities.
Meanwhile, the O Paneerselvam-led AIADMK faction on Monday rejected Dinakaran's call to return to the parent party. The rebel camp, however, refused to accept his leadership. The EC cancelled the by-poll to the RK Nagar Assembly seat, which was scheduled for the 12th of April, saying that the electoral process had been corrupted through the use of Manipa. The by-poll had become necessary owing to the death of the then Chief Minister J. Jalalitha last December. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
On to some more news, Nepalese President Vidya Devi Bhandari received a ceremonial reception at the Rashtrapati Bhavan today. Nepalese President is in India on a five-day visit, carrying a message of friendship and the intent to strengthen bilateral ties between the two nations. She is expected to meet Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari, External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj, Home Minister Rajnath Singh and Finance Minister Arun Jaitley during her visit. She will also meet President Pranab Mukherjee and Prime Minister Narendra Modi to explore ways to step up cooperation between India and Nepal. The ties between the two neighbours has faced some strains following the agitation by the Madhesi community. This is the first state visit of President Bhandari after assuming office in October 2015. The Nepalese president is accompanied by a high-level delegation comprising ministers, members of parliament and senior officials. The CBI on Monday booked 12 top TMC leaders, including MPs and ministers, in connection with the Narda sting operation case. The list comprises the who's who of TMC leadership and also an IPS officer. The TMC leaders against whom the CBI has registered the FIR include Rajya Sabha MP Mukul Roy, Lok Sabha MP Sugata Roy, Aparupa Poddar, Sultan Ahmed, Prasoon Bajpai and Kakoli Ghosh Dastidar. The CBI in its FIR claimed that it had conducted forensic analysis of the tapes, which showed that the recordings had not been tampered with. Drawing a sharp reaction, Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee has called it a political game and said we'll fight it politically. Meanwhile, West Bengal's BJP wing has demanded immediate resignation of the tainted cabinet ministers of West Bengal. In the sting operation, which was claimed to have been conducted during April and May 2014, the TMC leaders were seen purportedly accepting money from representatives of fictitious company in return for favours. NardaNews.com had released the tapes last year, just before the assembly elections.
Illegally, we are ready to fight legally, not to tell anything.
What do you think is a conspiracy? You are saying?
It's a conspiracy. It's already established. साजिश है ये तो मालूम हो गया साबित हो गया. 2016 के चुनाव की पहले तो साजिश था established हो गया. मेरा कुछ बोलने का सवाल ही नहीं है legal fight होगा.
Calcutta High Court has given a verdict. Supreme Court has upheld it. CBI after investigation has filed FIR against 12 TMC leaders and one serving police official. All the TMC leaders who have been named in the FIR, it enjoins on the TMC government that they should be all removed from their position that they hold in the government. But then you cannot expect much from the Trinamool Congress, because this party has nothing left so far as morality is concerned, so far as principles are concerned.
Meanwhile, all schools and colleges in Kashmir Valley will remain shut today. This comes after hundreds of students hit streets across the valley yesterday. They were protesting against a crackdown at a Pulwama college 2 days ago. The call for Monday's protest was given by a little-known student's body, Kashmir University Students Association Union. More than 60 students were injured in clashes with police and paramilitary forces. Police fired pellet, tear, smoke, shells and pepper grenades to quell the protest. Meanwhile, the Union Home Ministry on Monday asked the security forces to use non-penetrative plastic bullets in place of pellet guns to tackle stone pelters and violent mobs during protests in Jammu and Kashmir. However, the non-lethal pellet gun would continue to be in use as an alternative, to be used only as a last resort. The Supreme Court had last month asked the centre to consider effective means other than the use of pellet guns to quell stone pelting mobs in the state. The centre on Monday reviewed the security situation in Jammu and Kashmir in order to bring normalcy in the valley. The meeting, chaired by Home Minister Rajnath Singh, was also attended by National Security Advisor Ajit Doval, besides others. The meet took stock of the prevailing situation in the state, which saw massive violence during the April 9th by-poll to Srinagar Lok Sabha seat. During the meet, it was discussed whether peace dialogue with any separatist groups wielding influence on the protesters could be initiated. The Home Minister had already announced that the central government was ready for the talks with anyone within the framework of the constitution, an offer the separatists are not ready to accept. The meeting also discussed the ways to deal with the series of videos which portray security forces in bad light. According to the sources, authenticity of the videos are also a matter of serious question, as many of them were protested in social media sites from Pakistan. Unprovoked firing by Pakistani troops on forward Indian positions along the line of control in Nowshera sector has been continuing at intermittent intervals for the last 3 days. The latest incident of ceasefire violation from across the border came at around 8 a.m. on Monday when Pakistani troops resorted to mortar shellings besides automatics and small arms fire. Indian Army retaliated strongly and effectively. There have been no casualty or damage on the Indian side. Significantly, Pakistani troops had resorted to firing in the area on Saturday and Sunday as well. And upping the ante, Pakistan's army has ruled out consular access to Kulbhushan Jadhav, who they have alleged of spying. This development comes days after India had made a strong case for the access to the Indian prisoner on death row. Meanwhile, Indian officials have maintained that there was no communication from Pakistan on the denial of consular access. Pakistan army has claimed that Jadhav was involved in anti-state activities, so he had to face court-martial and that all legal requirements were fulfilled in his trial, which resulted in his conviction. Islamabad, however, has said that Jadhav could appeal against the judgment in the army appellate court and then to the army chief against the decision of the appellate court. He can also file an appeal to the Supreme Court and the President of Pakistan. Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurated a slew of projects in Surat and Dadra and Nagar Haveli on Monday. The visits assume significance as assembly elections in Gujarat are slated for this year and the BJP could witness a fight from the Patidhar community seeking reservation.
On the second day of his visit to Gujarat on Monday, Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurated a charitable hospital in Surat. The 400 crore rupee multi-super speciality hospital and research center is built by a not-for-profit body, the Samast Patidar Arogya Trust. The Prime Minister indicated that the government may bring in a legal framework under which doctors will have to prescribe generic medicines that are cheaper than branded drugs to patients.
Abhi health policy ghoshit ki hai. Atal ji ki sarkar ke baad 15 saal ke baad is sarkar ne health policy lai hai lekin gareeb ke liye madhyam varg ke liye aarogya sevaye sucharu rup se uplabdh ho us disha mein sarkar ek ke baad ek kadam utha rahi hai hum kanoonan aur vyavastha karne wale hain doctor parchi likhenge us pe likhenge ki generic dawa khareedne ke liye uske liye kaafi hai aur dawa khareedne ki zarurat nahi hai.
Modi also inaugurated a fully automatic cattle feed plant and an ice cream plant of Sumul Dairy at Bajipura village in Tapi district. Bajipura mein Modi aaya. Later, in neighboring Silvassa, the Prime Minister inaugurated a slew of government projects, including Passport Seva Kendra and the Jan Aushadhi Kendras.
हमने एक सपना संजोया है 2022 जब आजादी के 75 साल होंगे हमारे देश का एक भी गरीब ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए जिसके पास रहने के लिए अपना खुद का घर न हो
Narendra Modi arrived in Surat on Sunday to a rousing reception, leading an 11-kilometer roadshow from the airport to the circuit house. This is the Prime Minister's second visit to Gujarat and the first to the Patidar community stronghold Surat after he assumed office in 2014. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari has underscored the need to raise the budget allocation for the education sector, especially primary education. Interacting with the students of Sharada University in Greater Noida, Ansari said India needs to lay emphasis on research to improve its global ranking.
Pointing out that India's allocation for the education sector is lower than many other nations, Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari said both the centre and states are shifting blame on each other.
Allocation both at the central government level and at the state level to education is abysmally low and is not targeted to achieving higher quantitative and qualitative results. It is unfortunate, but our public opinion is not willing to address this problem.
The Vice President emphasized the need to encourage research in the country. He also said India needs to recognize talent.
My thinking is that we made one fundamental mistake. We separated research from teaching. You see, the two are not separable.
The Vice President strongly advocated linking education with technology and skill development to keep pace with the changing times. Panchanan Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And here are some more updates from across the country nationwide. Canadian Defence Minister Harjeet Singh Sajjan arrived in India on a 7-day visit. During his visit, both the countries are expected to explore ways to deepen bilateral defence and security cooperation. He is also expected to have wide-ranging talks with Defence Minister Arun Jaitley and External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj. The drivers of two apps, Ola and Uber, are expected to go on strike for a day protesting long working hours and low fares. This is the second round of strike called by the drivers. The strike might hit private transport services in Delhi and neighbouring cities, as some of the group of tourist taxi providers, Auto Rickshaw Union, as per the agitating Sarvodaya Drivers Association, have extended their support to it. Social media platform WhatsApp's privacy policy matter has been referred to a constitution bench of Chief Justice J.S. Khehar and Justice D.Y. Chandrachur by the Supreme Court. The bench will hear the issue today. As per the bench, the parties should appear before it and formulate issues to be taken up for the hearing. Assam Chief Minister Sarbananda Sonowal on Monday met Chinese Ambassador to India Lau Xiaohui and discussed various issues of mutual interest and concern. Sonowal also stressed on the need to increase people-to-people contact and cultural exchange, which will bring the people of Assam and China closer and facilitate an environment of growth and prosperity. Controversial RJD leader Mohammad Shahabuddin was acquitted by the Jharkhand court on Monday in a triple murder case involving a railway contractor and a youth Congress leader 28 years ago due to lack of evidence. Shahabuddin, currently lodged in Tihar Jail, was produced before the court of Additional Sessions Judge Ajit Kumar Singh through video conferencing and was acquitted. The triple murder had taken place at Jugsalai on February 2, 1989. And with that, we'll slip into a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
Renowned economist Amartya Sen needs no introduction. Recipient of the Nobel Prize for Economics in 1998, Sen has always shown a keen interest in the problems of the underprivileged. He has made immense contributions to the discipline of welfare economics and social choice theory, and his books have been translated into more than 30 languages. In 2010, Amartya Sen was listed among the world's 50 most influential people who matter.
Welcome back. Wholesale price inflation eased to 5.7% in March on the back of softening prices of fuel and manufactured items. WPI inflation stood at 6.55% in February, but it was in the negative zone at -0.45% in March 2016. Fuel inflation declined to 18.16% from 21.02% in February. Manufactured items also witnessed a fall in prices, with inflation being recorded at 2.99% in March against 3.66% in the previous month. Food inflation, however, inched up to 3.12% in March from 2.69% in February on festival demand. On to some international news. Tensions are escalating in Korean Peninsula with heated rhetoric from both North Korea and the US. On Monday, North Korea said it will continue to test missiles despite international condemnation and growing military tensions with the US. A senior official told the BBC in Pyongyang that missile tests will continue and that an all-out war would result if US took military action. North Korea's UN Deputy Representative Kim In-ryong also issued threat of the nuclear war aimed at the United States. The developments come after U.S. Vice President Mike Pence warned the North Korea not to test the U.S. He said his country's era of strategic patience with the North Korea was over. Pence arrived in Seoul on Sunday, hours after North Korea carried out a failed missile launch. He warned North Korea not to test the resolve of the United States or the strength of its military forces. In order to counter North Korea, U.S. has sent a Navy strike group towards the Korean Peninsula. The U.S. and South Korea are also moving ahead with the early deployment of the controversial missile defense system.
If you continue to do that, if you like it, the Gangdo가 무장을 하고 자기 집에 뛰어들어가지고 가족 친척들을 다 멸살시키려고 할 때에 그 가만히 있을 사람은 하나도 없을 것이라고 생각한다고.
Between South Korea and the United States is the linchpin of peace and security, not only on the Korean Peninsula, but indeed throughout the Asia Pacific. The United States' commitment to South Korea is ironclad. The President and I have great confidence that China will properly deal with North Korea. But as President Trump made it clear just a few days ago, if China is unable to deal with North Korea, the United States and our allies will.
And allaying the widespread criticism over a referendum granting sweeping new powers to the Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, he warned the international election observers to know their place. Addressing crowds of flag-waving supporters from the steps of the presidential palace in Ankara, Erdogan said that Sunday's results had ended all the debate on changing the constitution and creating an executive presidency. According to the election authorities, preliminary results showed 51.4% of voters had backed the biggest overhaul of Turkish politics since the founding of the modern republic in Sunday's referendum. Meanwhile, the European monitors observed that the vote did not live up to the international standards. Erdogan said that Turkey did not see, hear, nor acknowledge reports by the Organization for the Security and Cooperation in Europe, which is an observer mission.
AGİT diye bir örgüt var Avrupa'da. Şimdi bunlar kendilerine göre bir rapor hazırlıyorlar. Türkiye'deki seçimler şöyle olmuş, böyle olmuş. Önce haddinizi bilin, haddinizi.
And let's take a look at all the other international developments in World Rap. The two front runners in France's presidential elections staged rival rallies on Monday to win over undecided voters. Marine Le Pen, National Front party leader, said in her rally in Paris that the choice was between her rivals' savage globalization and her patriotism. Emmanuel Macron, in his rally, asserted that the country was ready for a change. On April 23rd, the French go to polls to choose two candidates from a field of 11 who will go through a runoff 2 weeks later. U.S. police are on a lookout for a gunman who shot a grandfather on a street in Ohio and posted the footage on Facebook. The suspect, Stephen, said in another video post that he had killed 13 people and would kill more. Police have asked residents of Ohio, Indiana, Michigan, New York and Pennsylvania to be on an alert. Cleveland officials have also offered a $50,000 reward for information that leads to his location. U.S. President Donald Trump will today sign an executive order directing federal agencies to recommend changes to the country's visa policies. The target will be the H-1B visa program that brings foreign workers to the U.S. to fill high-skilled jobs. The order is an attempt by the Trump administration to carry out his America First campaign pledges to reform U.S. immigration policies. And in a big blow to former BCCI President N. Srinivasan, the Supreme Court on Monday said that he can't represent the board at the ICC meeting to be held on 24th of April. The Apex Court said it is allowing BCCI Acting Secretary Amitabh Chaudhary to represent the board at the meeting. The court also added that the BCCI CEO Rahul Johri can accompany Chaudhary for the meeting. Explaining its verdict, a bench headed by Justice Deepak Mishra stated that since Srinivasan was held guilty for conflict of interest, he can't be allowed to represent the BCCI in the ICC meeting. On April 10, the Apex Court had said that the person who is ineligible to become an office bearer in the BCCI and state cricket associations cannot be nominated to take part in the ICC meetings. And that's all we have for you in this edition of Breakfast News. See you again tomorrow, same time. Till then, keep watching Rajya Sabha TV.